session that we have planned on an illuminated world. And I am Supriya Rai from the KJ Somaiya Institute of Dharma Studies. I wanted to very briefly introduce our institution. Some of you may already know that at Somaiya Vidya Vihar, first of all, we became a private university in the August of 2019 now, yes. And at that time, we had three institutions which were dedicated to what we call religious and cultural studies. So there was a center for Sanskrit and Hindu texts, there was a center for Buddhist studies, and a center for studies in Jainism. Once we became private university, what we have done is we have brought them all together under this overarching umbrella institution called the KJ Somaiya Institute of Dharma Studies. And we really interpret Dharma in the broadest sense over here. And our brief is to, of course, develop the three earlier institutions. They continue in the same way, but to develop a more interlinked focus and take that interlinkages into areas that we may earlier not have necessarily been present in, which brings me to the topic under discussion today. There is somewhat of a history to what we are doing here. about 2 years ago, we started a digitizing program at the Institute. It's nested under our Institute. This is digitizing the private collection of the Somaiya family. There are art objects, there are manuscripts. And the idea, of course, is to create a resource, a sort of primary resource, and also to sensitize students on our campus. For those of you who don't know Somaiya Vidya Vihar, we have 34 institutions, and at our Vidya Vihar campus on any given day, when we are open, of course, and in a non-COVID situation, we have about 27,000 students who come every day in various disciplines, including, of course, engineering and management, but also arts, science, commerce, teacher education, vocational education. There are a number of institutions here. And the reason we are digitizing this is to not just for the cognoscenti, but also to sensitize our students to objects of heritage and, you know, just factor in simple things like how do you look at an object? When you look at an object of antiquity, what is it that you see, you know, and just start working around everything that we collect and that we possess that sensitizes our students to the richness and the vastness of arts and culture in our country. And so today we start off a whole program. Actually, this is now going to be a continuous engagement. Today is the first session of engaging with people from the field who bring to bear their work and their study into the kind of disciplines that we want to have at our institution later. I would also like to share this point that one of the things we have planned on campus is a museum. And of course, a very, very important part of that is going to be outreach. And our partner in crime, so to say, in all of this is the wonderful Dipti Shashidharan. She refuses to be introduced formally. So I have just the one line to say about her, which is that she is from ECA. But I will add a couple of lines more beyond that, that she is simply this wonderful bundle of energy who brings her passion and her commitment to the kind of work we are doing. She's been leading the digitizing project. She's very much involved with the museum project. And we are looking at developing this field with all seriousness at our university so that tomorrow we have a repository of resources that would do us proud, not just as a university, but in terms of also the kind of research that we make available. So with that little bit of an introduction, I'm going to hand you over to Dipti, and she will take it forward. All yours, Dipti.
Thank you, Supriya. Good evening, and thank you all for joining us today evening. Supriya's brief but very apt introduction it really sums it all up. At Somaya, we are trying to create a museum, but from the beginning want to create a museum where the Somaya audiences, students, staff, faculty, and indeed anyone who has a passion for the arts is able to come in and understand what they see there. So we've got big plans, but for now we are kicking off this session, this series of talks that will introduce basically the concept of various aspects of art to laypersons. We have a peculiar situation where in the university campus we have extremely qualified and world-renowned scholars, but sometimes they all work in silos and we don't get to meet and talk about especially topics and disciplines like the fine arts, and also because there's a paucity of being able to view and see these collections in the real world. With COVID, that's only been heightened. So one of the things we wanted to do was to be able to bring some of the topics out into the general forum. And I'm absolutely delighted to welcome a young scholar here, Sonika Soni. Sonika will be talking to us today about traditional Indian paintings, and her title of her talk is very cleverly called An Illuminated Word World. And this is because so much of the Indian painted genre is as much as about words, the philosophy, the thoughts, the ideas behind them, as it is about the visual representation of them. And people often look at a painting and zone out because they don't understand what they are looking at. So let me quickly get the niceties over with. I'm going to introduce Sonika, who joins us today. I've known her a long time, and it's been such a joy to see her, her journey. Sonika was born in and trained in a family of traditional painters, and so therefore a natural interest in researching and mastering traditional techniques and styles. She's an India Foundation for the Arts grants awardee and has worked on a number of private and royal art collections. She has a degree in a master's in art history from the Faculty of Fine Arts, MSU Vadodara, and a postgraduate diploma in museology and conservation, which is her other great love, from CSMBS Mumbai. The ability to combine art history, museology, and conservation, I think, gives her a very unique advantage. And of course, even at this young age, she's has several publications. She's done Gauri Dances with Map in India, Painting and Photography at the Jaipur Court by Niyogi Books, a volume titled The Indian Portrait, The Eighth Archer, and so on. Sonika also heads later this year to the Rietberg Museum, Zurich, where she's going to work on the Boston Bundi Ragmala. And before I hand over the platform to Sonika, I just wanted to add that today's talk is not one of those strict, heavy, pedantic art history talks. It is, but it isn't. Because after the series of discussion and nested under the whole concept of give and take of the Institute of Dharma Studies, we are going to introduce traditional Indian paintings and its different aspects by looking at the very basic building blocks, which are basically materials, techniques, along with a focus on the purpose of painting activity in the courtly and religious context. And of course, we look at the beautiful aesthetics, because how can you not? But we will also look at what's a school, what's a style, the concepts of space, the sacred, the profane, and also something that is deeply interests Sonika at the moment, which is the role of ancient treatises, literally liturgical sources, and medieval texts, which she's pursuing at the moment. So Sonika, welcome. Thank you. And it's such a pleasure to see you from a distance. Sonika joins us from Pune today. Over to you.
Hey, Deepti. Am I audible? Thank you very, very much for the glorious introduction.
Yes.
And just a minute. So, like you said, that today's talk is basically not about not necessarily about the chronology of painting as we would study in like in an art historical discipline. What we have done is like pulled out some of the really interesting aspects of painting which we would not otherwise see, and only like a selection of paintings wherein able to see like really fun things going on in the paintings. And I have largely divided this session in three parts. The first, which I think is really important and interesting, deals with the ancient and early medieval prescriptive texts. And so this talk is basically is going to be about how and what goes into making of a painting, keeping it specially in the context of Indian paintings, and also at the same time, how and what takes for a viewer to qualify to be able to relish the artworks. And for these, I will largely be deriving from Vishnu Dharmottar Puran. So Vishnu Dharmottar Puran was one such text which was written somewhere between 5th and 6th century CE. And before that, all the Puranas dealt with the art of painting, but only cursorily. But Chitra Sutra, the Vishnu Dharmottar Puran was one such text which devoted an entire khanda or one section, which is the third part, to the art of painting. It's called the Chitra Sutra. And Chitra Sutra, ka, one of the shlokas says that Yatha Sumeru Pravaro Naganam, Yathand Jana Garuda Pradhanaha, Yatha Jananam Pravaraha Kshitishastha, Kalanam Miha Chitra Kalpaha. That means that like Sumeru is the most glorious of all the mountains, like eagle is chief among all other birds, and like king is the best of all the human beings, similar status should be given to the art of painting among all other art, all other arts. So let's travel into the majestic world of Indian paintings, which is at some length strange and otherworldly, but at the same time very familiar to all of us, as given to us imbibed in our culture and our religion. The art of painting as prescribed in older treatises can be seen as a way of coming one-to-one with all that is philosophical, all that is spiritual, all that is religious and divine, and at the same time sacrosanct. This world of paintings at the same time is a fascinating world of the Nagarikas and Rasikas. Here I'm going to use both the terms, the Nagarika and Rasika, is gender neutral. Both of these terms are described by these texts as for the learned population, but like for our convenience, let's call them the Nagarikas and Rasikas as the informed population and the informed audience. And amongst these Nagarikas and Rasikas, some became artists and some qualifies to be the viewers or spectators or connoisseurs. And according to Vishnu Dharmottar Puran and other prescriptive texts, both of them have very, very important roles to play. And also here we must remember that all these texts, they are largely religious and philosophical in nature, and they prescribe or give methods to achieve the highest forms of pleasure, dexterity, and experience. Here I would like to start again with the Chitra Sutra, which in the beginning states about the artist, and it actually prescribes the artist that how a painter should wake up early in the morning, take a bath, wear clean white clothes, do yoga and meditation, recall his deities and gurus, face the east direction and begin his artwork while seated in the Veera Asana, and begin the work by meditating on all things which are auspicious according to the Pratima Lakshanas given by these texts. I'll talk more about the Pratima Lakshanas. But what is fascinating here is there are these two portraits. One is of artist Daulat, the self-portrait of artist Daulat, and another is a portrait of artist Abul Hasan. And both of them are seated actually in Veera Asana. And here if we see this left portrait of Daulat, he is exactly wearing the white clothes, and in both of them are seen in meditative postures. And both of these are Mughal paintings, and which were done much, much ahead of when these texts were written. And the equations of painting activity were changed drastically after the painting activity started in the Mughal courts. But here, what is fascinating is to notice that the Indic traditions are still continued. We still see these artisan Veera Asanas. And if we can actually look at a tiny detail in these two portraits, these are both both the portraits of artists seated in the prescribed positions. But if we see in the left, where this artist Daulat, he's painting with his right hand. But the other artist seemed to be a lefty in his painting exactly with his left hand. So that is the kind of detail which was favored by Akbar, the Mughal courts, which we'll talk in length about in the later sections of it. So coming back to the prescriptive texts, the Chitra Sutra of Vishnu Dharmuttar Puran gives these pratima, stressed on the pratima lakshanas. Pratima lakshana, so here pratima, word pratima is basically meant for both sculptures and art of painting. And pratima lakshanas comprises of iconography and iconometry. That is, it gives the measurements or the talaman or the measurements for a range of people, including gods and demigods and deities and Bhut and Pret and Pishach and Nayakas and Nayikas, that is the common man, and all of them. There is a further categorization on each about the kind of figure types, about their limbs, about the weapons, accessories, musical instruments which should accompany them, and the animals and birds which should surround, and the signs and symbols for each of them, and all, as well as the drashti, that is the gaze that they should be looking with, and the mudras, and the asanas, bhang and movement, that is basically the postures and hand gestures. And the list goes on and on. Besides these, besides the Chitra Sutra, the other prescriptive texts which stressed on specific aspects of paintings, I would like to name a few. The Natya Shastra basically stresses upon the rasa. Now, rasa is loosely be described as, not loosely, it literally translates to the juice or the nectar. And it basically means by the ultimate aesthetic experience. The other test, Aparajit Prucha, stresses upon the rasa, rekha, bhushan, and alankar, that is the essence, lines, ornamentation in a painting. Then there is text called Shilpa Ratnakar, which stress upon bhav and rasa, that is the essence on the emotions which an artwork is supposed to express. The Kama Sutra of Vatsyayana, which talks at length, which prescribes about the erotic lovemaking positions, also talks about the art of painting, and it gives the Shadanga, that is the six limbs, which should be composite, which should be an essential part of a good artwork, which are the Roop Bhed Pramanani, Bhav Lavanya Yojanam, Sadrashya Varnika Bhang, Iti Chitra Shadangakam. So Vatsyayana says that these six limbs of to be qualified to be a good painting should be the distinction in forms, proportions, the infusion of emotions and sentiments, likeliness and verisimilitude, at the same time the division in colors. After Vatsyayana, in Samrangan Sutradhar, they added two more and made the eight limbs of art to go along with a good painting or as an exemplary painting. Rasamanjari, which was written by Bhanu Datta, gave a broad categorization and a very detailed categorization of Nayak Nayika. It's called Nayika Bhed, where he gives a distinction of the Nayaka Nayikas, that is hero or heroines, in basically based on their state of being and their position in love. Coming back to our Chitra Sutra, which gives canons of painting for an artist. So Chitra Sutra basically says that an artist, to be able to make a good painting, should know the art of dance, because that's where the postures and mudras are coming. And to be able to understand the dance, one should know Natya, that is drama and theater. And to be able to understand drama and theater, one should have a know-how of musical instrument. And to get a know-how of musical instrument, one should also know the vocal music. And vocal music is what? But the sounds which are created or sung in such a way that they give the aesthetic experience. So for to be able to understand that, one should know the bhasha, which is language, and should also know dhvani, which is grammar and literature. And likewise, it gives a full name dictionary, that is the Abhidhan Kosh, which an artist must know before he goes into making a painting. And then when an artist makes a painting which is composite of all the pratima lakshanas or all the characteristics, the Chitra Sutra says that such a painting is worthy of worshipping. And that should be the ultimate goal of an artist. Likewise, Chitra Sutra also prescribed about how, what about the prerequisites of a spectator or a rasika or a connoisseur, that to be able to understand or to be able to even see a painting, one should qualify in the 64 arts. There is a long list of different types of arts, which basically includes the art of painting and the subdivisions, that is the singing and musical instruments and dance and theater and painting. And it has a list of really interesting and fascinating arts, such as the painting of face and body with colors, preparing offering for from rice and flowers, and making a covering of bed with flowers, and cleaning your teeth, clothes, painting your body, making the groundwork of jewels, cleaning body with perfumes, the medicines, talking with birds, mineralogy, metallurgy, carpentry, and engineering, and the list goes on. If somebody is interested, you can actually Google it. There is full list available. But among these 64 arts, the one which I found really fascinating is the last one, which says the awakening a master with the music at dawn. So it basically is about sensitizing, or it's about being responsible, it's about being delicate and respectful to the surrounding or to the nature around us or to everything around us. And Chitra Sutra says that a rasika, when he has mastered these 64, or when he is at least aware of these 64 art, only then he becomes worthy of, or he becomes qualified to fully relish the aesthetic experience. And it's only then that he could do the rasa swadan, that is relishing the nectar that, or the juices or the aesthetic experience presented by the artworks, which are composite of the pratima lakshanas. And when artist looks at such a paint, and when a connoisseur looks at such a painting, he worships it. And worship, by worshiping, it does not mean like offering of flowers or doing an aarti. It happens with the chitta and mastish. It's an internal process where you feel revering or bowing down in front of a painting, and be respectful to the master artist who created such a painting. And Chitta Sutra also says that by worshiping a painting or an image, image which has the full characteristics can actually fulfill your desires, or fulfill your desires, by which means that you can actually lead a happily life in this birth and the births to come. Now there's this fascinating painting which was done in Mewat school, which shows a similarity between what we were talking about, which is basically a worshipping of a painting which is worthy of fulfilling your desires. Here what we see, this is a narrative composition wherein an episode is presented sequentially. So where we see Radhika appearing at least 6 times in the composition, Krishna, but he is making her wait. She's waiting and waiting and waiting. So that's why we see the waiting expanded in 3 different, it's the same bhava, but it's shown 3 times to just force upon the factor that she is waiting. And then after that, she goes on preparing a bed with flowers and also puts liquors to entice Krishna, but he still doesn't come. And her last resort is to go and worship an image, which I believe is composite of all the pratima lakshanas that we just talked about. She pleads in front of the art. She is literally saluting it. If we see the tiny detail in the center of the painting, she's saluting the painting. She's crying in front of it, howling. And she's worshiping so that her desires get fulfilled. And her desire is to see and meet Krishna. Now what's happening here is, if we see in the bottom right corner, we see a sakhi who is approaching Krishna. So sakhi saw this drama happening and she could see Radhika in distress. So she goes to Krishna and explains her situation to him, and then requests that you must visit her. And not in this particular folio, but in the successive folios, we actually see Radha's desire fulfilling. Krishna actually comes and meet her. So this is the kind of relevance we can see between what was written in the text centuries before and what artist actually painted.
Yeah.
In the 1680s. Dipti, would you like to add to it?
Yeah, I'm absolutely stupefied by how the art of painting was raised almost to a level of this exalted status. The fact that, as you were explaining, that you had to be a connoisseur and you had to immerse yourself in literally every shade of color to be able to appreciate this kind of visual treat that appears before you. But I had another question, Sonika, I was saying, which is like, perhaps you're going in that direction already. I wanted to, so in the olden days, yes, I understand you had to be part of the informed population. And I think you had to be well-versed in these 64 different arts. But for those of us who are here hoping that you will drop some nuggets of how to look at these paintings with or without your guidance, tell me, how do we begin to look at, which I understand is really a Western nomenclature of what you classify as a school and as a style. One of the things we want to demystify through these talks is that that paintings are not really a closed window, but very much, as Radhika says, something to be saluted as. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah. This is really interesting. See, the thing is, these words, these terms, style, the individual style and indigenous style and school of painting, they actually appeared much later. They were not Indian terms, as we can see. They came when art history became a discipline and when it got, when, you know, it became a discipline to be studied and researched upon. But before we get into all of that, you know, I would actually like to start with what is the range that Indian painters gave to us. You know, what are the kind of paintings, what do we actually mean when we say Indian painting? Because it's not just like a two-dimensional painting. There are very many aspects to it. There are very many types to it. So can I begin with, you know, the different, by explaining different types of paintings that were made in India?
Yeah, sorry, I think I was muted off. Yeah, please go ahead. Go ahead.
So beginning with the types of paintings that have been produced in India, right from the times of Ajanta paintings, which is also corresponds to the time of when the Chitra Sutra was written. In fact, there is a constant debate going on whether the Chitra Sutra supplemented Ajanta paintings or the Ajanta paintings, which are so beautifully made that they supplemented the writing down of the canons for the
canonical. Yeah, absolutely. Because I imagine a project like the painting of the Ajanta murals would have brought together some set of rules that groups of artists have wanted to pass on.
Yeah. So there is a broader categorization, which is that the paintings which we see as groups or sets, and then there are loose folios. So let's begin with the groups. The first is the wall paintings. Obviously, in the wall paintings, for example, in the Ajanta painting, and the other example is a detail from the Badal Mahal in the Bundi Fort. And then we actually get to see a lot of wall art in temples, in many palaces and forts, and the older caves. But here, we usually do not see like one single image of a particular person. They are usually a club of paintings, or they are based on some theme. For example, Ajanta, they basically tells you about, they are illustration of all the Jataka stories, which basically deal with the Buddha's life and his previous births as well. And then in the later forts and palaces, we usually get to see a lot of paintings based on Krishna themes, which actually we'll talk about that, why Krishna and why religious paintings basically. But a lot of them have to deal with the religious subjects, so to say. The other type of paintings that we come across are the illustrated and illuminated manuscripts. Now, illustrated manuscripts are basically the manuscripts wherein there is a text written and there are images which supplement to the text. And on each folio, like here, the image may not necessarily contribute to what is written next to it, but they still supplement to the overall, the writing in the text. So here what we see is, there's this Prajnaparamita Sutra. Now it is in this particular picture, it is being taken out and it is being prepared for worshipping.
Amazing, yeah. I can see the sindoor, you know, the...
Exactly.
Sometimes... Yeah, I also wanted you to share your perspective. I know you're not dipping into it today, but as a conservator, sometimes you look under the microscope for these telltale signs, don't you, of whether there's turmeric or whether there is worshipping powders.
Yeah. So that happens like not just in these manuscripts. I mean, we get to see all of these things a lot in tankas, which are still worshipped, and a lot of Jain tantras. then pattas, which are based on tantric subjects.
And they're
painting, exactly. So they're there. I mean, they are not necessarily good for artworks always, but then they were made for a purpose. So we cannot deny it. We cannot go against it.
Absolutely.
And there's this one text called Ashtasahitra Prashna Paramita, which has these covers on the front and the top that we saw in this painting also, this particular artwork also, that there is a embellished front and back cover between which these painted folios, these are made on palm leaves. Because before the paper came in India and before paper became like one signature material to be painted upon, their manuscripts were painted on palm leaves. Now there's this one fascinating group of paintings that we usually come across. They are called the Murakkas. Now Murakkas were basically, they were made in for Mughal courts in the Mughal ateliers. And some of the albums were made to be bound as albums. They were to be a part of one single album. But a lot many times, a number of paintings which were created of different sizes, but then they were to be kept together. Yeah. To make a sense out of them and to basically for the purposes of storage. So they these paintings, exactly. So then these paintings were they were basically embedded in these hand-painted borders. There were pastiches which were put all around so that they could all come to one uniform size and could be kept as one album. Now often these albums have beautiful illuminated front and back covers. And there's this one picture, if you see at the bottom, is basically how you would look at a Murakka folio. So on one side would be the painting and the other side is often the verses and poetry, which may or may not illustrate, which may or may not go with what is painted. The third side kind of set that we get to see is theme based. Now here on the left side is this a folio from the Hamzanama manuscript, which was done in Akbar, which was one of the most ambitious projects, which was done in the early Akbari phase, where the Hamzanama, which is basically the deeds of Uncle Hamza of Prophet Muhammad, were painted. And here in this particular folio, where we see that there's a in the center, if you can see, there's a lady who has come dressed as a male armor to rescue her fellows, which again is like a very fascinating subject that was painted in Akbar's time. And these other folios are from Geet Govinda manuscript, which were painted in Mewad and other Rajput courts. So the top one is from Mewad and the below one is from Bashauli. So they usually come in sets. Now, because of the various purposes, these sets have been dispersed. And we see one folio or, you know, like a dispersed folio in different collections and museums. But earlier they were made as part of the set. Then there are these Ganjifa cards. I included Ganjifa cards because the technique of making of these Ganjifa cards is exactly similar to the paintings, the other Kotli paintings. Then there are these Gutkas, which are also the portable. Sorry,
Sonika, you'll have to explain Ganjifa. I'm sure there are members in our audience who don't know what Ganjifa means.
Ganjifa are the playing cards. Like we have a deck of cards these days. Earlier, it was like one of the most popular recreation.
It's one of our lost games, really. And it's a pity that we get to see them only in museums now.
And I think the art of playing is also lost. I don't think a lot of people know how to play with these cards also.
Maybe that's one thing, Supriya, we can do. Play Ganjifa one of them.
Play Ganjifa in our free time. And the other set or like the tiny booklets, which are called the Gutkas. Gutka meaning something which is small. And these are tiny booklets which one could carry with them all the time. And they are basically the darshans of different deities. Now coming back to the loose folios, are the sabi, that is the portraits. And these portraits came into being, they became really popular only after the Mughal court atelier started the painting activity, because for the Mughal court, these portraits were a tool, they were used as a political tool, as a political statement. For example, here in this portrait, we say that this is Jahangir holding a portrait of Akbar. Now we know from history that Jahangir and Akbar were not in very good terms, but Jahangir nonetheless wanted to say or pass a statement to the world by commemorating through a painting that, yes, his father gave him the empire and gave the entire world to him. That's why we see a symbolic globe which is held by Akbar, who is, in at least in the painting, in a painting, is presenting it to his son Jahangir. So, you know, so these are the kind of political statements, you know, these portraits often made.
Sanctification of sorts for father's legacy to son.
Exactly.
Still carrying on in other worlds.
Yeah, that's true. And then we see a lot of loose paintings in the form of shikar paintings. And this particular one is from Kota. And I mean, we don't have much time and I don't want to go into the each and every detail that is given into this particular painting. But I would just like to quote what Stuart Carey Welch, one of the great scholars of our times, stated about this particular painting, that when you actually look at it, where, how you're supposed to see is that you feel the thud of the feet and lashing of the ropes and hear the clang of the bells of the elephant who is here jumping and trying to catch this rhinoceros. There is this other shikar painting which is fabulous. It's from the times of Jagat Singh II. It was done in Mewat in Udaipur, and it is done by artist Jeeva. Now we see what we see here is an entire narration or the entire episode of how a shikar actually took place. And there is actually an entry point to how to read this composition. And there is a travel route. And then also the artist has left cues to how to actually exit also to out of the composition. And in this main painting, if we see at the bottom, at the right bottom, there are these bards anchored here, which basically tells us that this is the route, the Maharana Jagat Singh II, who came in for shikar. And here I would actually like to add that shikar was one of the favorite pastimes of these Maharanas. It was not just a pastime, it was actually a ritual, because there were jungles before, which are not so popular in our times. They were actually dense jungles. And shikar was done as a ritual each year in a specific month, and a specific number of the animals were to be killed to keep a check on the population of these animals. Otherwise, they would create havoc for the normal population. So by the beginning of each hunting season, as the Maharanas and the entire troop went for shikar, and when they came in with the trophy animals, there would be a large procession each time. So here in the bottom, we see that these bards, they have entered, and here they actually embark themselves. There is a screen on behind which the Maharana is seated. Now, what happening in this entire composition, that they are shooting only one single tiger. And all these tigers that we see in this painting is basically one tiger, which is documented the way he routed. So here what we see, and Maharana Jagat Singh II appears three times in this composition. So here at the bottom, what happens is to lure the tiger, they put a dead buffalo in an open ground. Tiger came in, and then exactly when he came in the range of Maharana, he shot it. Tiger was not instantly killed. He was led to one direction. Now where we see in the jungle, there were men already placed at several locations, and then their job was to distract the tiger or to actually give him a direction to go. And this they did it with the means of fireworks and by creating strange noises by musical instruments. And here we see, as the tiger went in the jungle, Maharana also came in. And here if we see the detail, this one, he's being carried in a palki where he's following the route of the tiger. And then that tiger, poor fellow, was finally led at the top of the composition. If we see, there was a group already ready with the trained shikari dogs, the Andalusian and other dogs, which for them it was really easy to attack a already wounded tiger, and they finally killed it. And here in this detail, in the center right, if we see, and there is a detail here, we see on this elephant, the trophy tiger, the dead body of it tied to it, and Maharana finally moving out of the composition.
So it's almost like an animation, like a stopgap animation that is compressed into one folio.
Into one two-dimensional composition. It is a way of documenting also. See, this is the only way of documenting a very important event.
Yeah, I always find that fascinating every time you take us through a painting, because it's what you began the talk with, the way of seeing it. To a layman, I see it and there is one tiger going all over the place, and then there's somebody with a nimbus who appears three times shooting into the air, sometimes on a palki, and you're like, what is going on? There's a lot of green. But I think that really makes a difference when, you know, you kind of guide us on how to see it. The eye really travels from the bottom of the picture, and you're on scene one. There is a sense of movement of this desperate, wounded tiger trying to escape, and the triumphant shikari actually going with his halo intact and on a palki like it's an everyday job. And then finally the spoils of the kill that are being taken away, and I can well imagine the procession you mentioned when all these hundreds of tiger skins and animal skins are literally paraded into the city. What a sight.
They paraded into the city, exactly. And they were like grand worship, which happened right before and after the shikar sequence ended or began.
Yeah.
Moving on to the next one. So in the loose paintings, we also see the documentation of the activities which happened at the courts. For example, here is a celebration of Holi festival. And again, like, you know, in a continuous narration, like we saw in the last painting, here also we see the Maharana. Now that there is a lot of color splatter going on in the composition, the only way to distinguish, and there are so many horsemen, so the only way to distinguish the Maharana in this crowd would be to provide him with a green and a golden halo behind the face, which is a way of distinguishing him. And also, then again, it's a documentation, and also tracing the movement of how exactly the entire episode happened, how they played Holi. Because for us, they just splattered color at each other. You know, we will think of so many other things, but exactly artist wanted to show the exact path which was taken, and the you know, the movement of the color also, the way it was sprayed around. So I think it's like a fabulous painting. It's done by Tara, which was one of the most prominent painters of Swaroop Singh's time.
So it's a great sense of movement. Yeah.
Then moving on to Mohammad Shah Rangila. He's called Rangila because he was actually colorful, and he was famous for his harem, which had, I don't know how many
countries
in it. Yeah. And he made actually, you know, this thing that wherever he traveled, even if he were to make an appearance in the court, he would always be carried by females in his palki. That was a kind of luxury he could enjoy, and that got documented in the paintings. Then in the loose painting, we saw a lot of architectural drawings, which were done in the mostly in the later Mughal phases. So there we see two different things. One is the tomb of Hidmatullah and one is Taj Mahal. Then all the famous architectures across India were painted. Then there are these really interesting things which are not very common. These are called Gattaji, and they are popular in mostly in Gujarat and Rajasthan. And these are these portable darshan boxes. So one could actually carry them anywhere. These are tiny boxes, you know, see, just like this big. I think I have one like kept here. Just this big, and you open it. So on one side there is a deity, and on one side there is a mirror. So basically layering the darshan at least two times. So there, wherein you open it, you darshan yourself also, and you take a darshan of your deity also.
It's like a thing. So tell me, Sonika, in the images that you just showed, where, if at all, was there a line between the sacred and the secular?
Oh, yes, that's really interesting. The sacred and secular, you know, we have to go back to the medieval times when the Bhakti movement came in, which sort of merged the boundaries of the two worlds. Because after the Bhakti movement, the kind of shlokas and the geets and the bhajans were written. God was supposed to be, you know, like with us, a part of us. And that actually got emulated in paintings much more, and offer, especially in the Rajput paintings we see. I will actually illustrate it with a few paintings that I have here in my presentation, that how the two worlds actually merged. Then in the loose folios, we often come across these scrolls which could be open. There are these, small bits of papers pasted together to form one long scroll. And so, for example, here, this is the depiction of Bhagavad Puran. So entire Bhagavad is illustrated in one long scroll, which I think is like more than 30 feet long. Then we also come across the paintings which were done in India also included a lot on Jain and Buddhist subjects. I don't want to go into the detailed, because that's like one large subject which we can like keep for some other presentation. And the other kind of paintings that we nowadays popularly see are the pitch wise, or the paintings pertaining to the Vallabhachari or the Pushtimarg sect, which is again an offshoot of the Bhakti movement that we are talking of, that we were talking about. Because Bhakti gave rise to this Pushtimargi sect, which was propounded by Vallabhacharya, who basically, you know, like talk about, he actually, you know, the Bhakti, this is like one fascinating aspect I'd like to talk about. This one term which Bhakti gave is called the Chitra Seva, which is the image worship, not more than image worship, is the image, the serving of an image, serving to an image.
And the Seva, the Chitra Seva, to this day in many homes. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. So there you not necessarily worship it, but you keep the deity in your home and you serve it,
absolutely,
as part of your family.
Yeah.
And then there are these, then there are obviously these paintings which could be custom made into frames or into doors or into anything.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So now I come to, after having seen all of these things, I think I should now in bring in the debate of what is the style versus the school. So when we say style, there are two things which we usually see in the Indian context, that is the individual style and an indigenous style. And then there is a larger concept of the school. Now, so development of school takes much longer than the development of indigenous and individual styles. It includes the practice in royal ateliers where painters were made to sit in a, where painters made like the, these artworks in a workshop pattern, where the workshop was headed by masters and attended by many other junior and newcomers, junior artists and newcomers. Paintings were made for the private viewing of royal family members and courtiers, and were reserved, or rather archived in these storages, which had different names in different courts. For example, in Udaipur, there was a Jodhan. In Mughal court, it was the Tasveer Khana. And in Jaipur, it was the Surat Khana, where the paintings were basically kept. And so when you see, when we talk about the style, we talk about all of these activities which were happening. So when we actually say Mewat school of paintings, what we basically mean is the individual style and the indigenous style which were practiced in the court right from the inception of the painting activity in that particular court till the present times. So in the context of Mewat school, we get to see Sahib Din's illustrated manuscripts which are done in the 17th century. We see the Amar Singh's second style in the Ari Singh. Now here, what is fascinating is that these styles came to be known by the names of their patrons rather than the painters. Also because they were greatly favored by the kind of the color palette, the choice of the color palette and the figures and the forms were favored by that particular Maharana, and that's why the style became popularly known by his name. So here in the Amar Singh's second painting, it's the Neem Kalam, which is a sweet pen or a mellowed down pen. It doesn't illustrate the otherwise bold color scale of the Mewat school. It is very subdued,
right,
and which was favored only by this particular Maharana. Yeah. And then there are these other examples, obviously, I pulled down to basically illustrate what a school would be composed of. Now I'd like to stress on what is an individual style and what is an indigenous style. Now, what we generally mean is something occurring at the same time, at the same place,
right,
which we can actually see it by the example of this one manuscript called Durga Pat, which was made in Jaipur school. Again, I say school because when we say school, we talk about every, like from the inception to the present times of all the styles.
Right.
So this particular manuscript, now all of these folios, I have written the name of artists below each. So these are zoom in sections of the Devi face, made for one particular manuscript. So right, that manuscript becomes done in an indigenous style, but done, each folio is done in an individual style, which then later on became part of the large Jaipur school. You see where
artist style, if I may put it differently, is a hallmark of, while he adheres to all of the broader prescriptions of the school, there is the stamp of individuality
that came in. Yes.
Every, I think it is the endeavor of every artist ultimately to leave some mark that of his individuality, or
that's
his
true.
these things.
That's true. That's
fascinating.
And other than this, you know, these regional schools that I say, oftentimes, you know, these some of the scholars and some of the institution use even broader terms for school. For example, I think I've seen like some examples at the National Museum and the Freer and Secular Art Gallery for wherein they, for a particular style of a painting or for a particular painting which would be of a particular period, they would largely say Rajput school. Now, when we say Rajput, we basically mean all the kingdoms in Rajasthan and in Himachal Pradesh. So it's a term of convenience and it's interchangeable.
Absolutely. That makes it easy that we should just enjoy the art and not be swept away by the...
Exactly. And I'd like to talk just like briefly about the types of materials and techniques which are still used by traditional painters. And if I go back to this particular style, and when I was talking about the individual style, it actually, these two terms, the style and schools, are not Indian terms. In India, what was used was the word kalam. Kalam mm-hmm. basically translates to the usage of the brush by a particular painter.
Absolutely.
And these are the kind of brushes that the artists use, which were made by either the sable hair or the squirrel hair. And the range of materials offered, which includes the pigments. The pigments are broadly divided into four or five categories based on the origin or the sources. So one categorization is the minerals, and which are basically the stones in making. They're not stones. You know, I would like to break a myth here that there is nothing called a stone color, because no stone gives actually color. If you grind a stone, it becomes white powder. It's the mineral which give color. And then the other categorization is organic, which again is, you know, it's loosely used as the vegetable colors.
Widely misused.
Again, no vegetable gives a color which could be used in a painting. We made vegetative dyes, not the vegetable dyes, but they have a different usage. Yeah. So the term which we can use here is the organic. For example, we use this particular pigment called indigo or neel, which is extracted out of the indigo plant.
Yeah, derived from an organic source, basically.
From an organic source. And for example, lemp, like where an artist collects the soot of a lemp and make a pigment, mix it with the gum arabic and use it for wherever he has to use.
Yeah.
And then there is metallic, which is the gold and silver, wherein the gold foils were either directly applied, the work, or the gold foils, and often the ink, which is also called the regional term is hilkari, which was made by beating down the gold foil further and literally grinding it mixed in the gum arabic and water. So these are the kind of pigments that were used. And then there is this paper, which in India was made at 2-3 centers called Sialkot, which is now in Pakistan, and Sanganer, which is close to Jaipur, and Gosunda, which is in Mewad. And paper, just like the one single paper, was used only for preparatory drawings. When somebody had to make a proper painting with colors and all, they used something called wasli, wherein the 2-3 papers would be joined together to make a thicker sheet, and then it would be coated with a primer, which is basically in khadiya. I have a list of processes, which is again going back to Chitra Sutra of Vishnu Dharmotar Puran, surprisingly, which is still followed by the artist till the day, wherein an artist begin his work by drawing the lines first, drawing the initial sketch, then filling of the colors, then giving the detailing into it, then doing the shade work, and then in the end doing the final lining and embellishment and the ornamentation of it. And in the end would be the eyes made for the purpose of darshan. And after the eyes have been made, there would be, you know, it's like a sacrosanct thing, that then the painting would not be touched.
Done.
Then it becomes something else. Then it becomes something divine.
Alive. Yeah. I think there similar outline is also carried when sculpture is made with slight variations. Yeah.
Exactly. So this is a picture from, again, a Mughal court, which basically shows the workshop setup, wherein here we see there's this artist Daulat on the left, and who is making a, if we see properly, I have put in a zoom in detail also, that he's actually making a portrait of the calligrapher who is seated right in front.
Yeah.
And then it also tells us about the pattern or the work in a, or the activities in a workshop that not just the painters would sit together and paint. It included the calligraphers, the bookbinders, and a whole lot of crafts and craftsmen who would sit and work together. And when I compare this painting, actually this is a picture taken, which was taken by me only, I think 3 or 4 years back in one of the streets in Udaipur. Artistic work, more or less like in a workshop pattern where it's usually headed by a master and there are these other people working around.
And they sit together and work.
And often, obviously, exchange the styles and ideas. And that's actually a way of learning about it, because right now there is no Chitra Sutra for these painters. But it's the tradition which is passed down from one generation to other.
Yeah, so you're talking a little bit about the physical proximity of how... in a workshop, painters sit together and work, and the collaborative effort, really, because you have sometimes it's collaborative, right? The word and the world, you say, they collide. But tell me also a little bit about the space and composition in the image itself, like in the painting. Did it get reflected from what they were seeing around them in their atelier specifically, or was this influenced by the patron? How did a painter really come to
include the spaces in the, so that's what, like, you know, I did this entire
decisions of spaces. Yeah,
exactly. So this last section of the presentation is basically dealing about how artists dealt with the space and how he composed this different spaces in one composition. There's this one beautiful folio from Mewad. It was done somewhere in the 1700s, and it's taken from the subject called Ramayan, which was painted, I think, in almost all the courts, including the Akbar's atelier. So in this particular composition, what is happening is it's divided by this diagonal line, and the background is divided by dark green and this yellow. And what is happening in this composition is two separate events, but happening at the same time, but happening at different geographical locations. So in one scene, we see King Dashrath, who's fallen sick because his son and daughter-in-law has gone out. And why have they gone out in the other? They are literally shown moving towards their vanavas. And they went because they were asked, they were ordered, they were commanded by Dashrath himself. So you see, though, both these events are happening at the same time, but at different geographical locations. And I think it was a very smart strategy devised by the painter to divide it by different, the background colors.
Like a diagonal demarcation with contrasting colors.
Contrasting. The color, so that's one strategy.
Very clever, yeah.
Yeah, and then we see, when there was this one artist, Mansoor, Ustad Mansoor, who was in Jahangir's atelier, and he is famous for his birds and animal studies. So Ustad Mansoor, so there is actually like one long paper also on how these exotic animals were brought from exotic lands, which is not India, obviously from anywhere in the world, to be seen by the patron, by Jahangir in this context. So the artist actually never went to see where these animals are coming from, but he still had the job to paint them. So how would we paint the background of it? How would we depict the place which he has not even seen? So he would make it neutral. So in this case, with the zebra background, it's neutral. There is nothing. It's just the zebra, because he's seen the zebra, but he's not seen where it's coming from, And these other two birds, which are brought from different parts of the world, it gave a very neutral, you see the kind of background which the patron's eyes are already accustomed and conditioned to. It's a typical Mughal background with these Indian flora, basically, so to say. So that's the smart strategy which Ustad Mansoor here devised.
Interesting.
To create the space. Now, this is like a really heavy composition, but nonetheless, I actually thought I would actually include it. It is done by this another master painter from Mughal Italia called Bichitra. And the border here is, interestingly, are done by somebody else. They're done by this illuminator called Hadi. And here what we see is Jahangir preferring a Sufi sheikh to the kings. Now, what's happening here in this painting is, see, if we see, there is this one Firang figure if we see here in the second figure that we see, he has been identified as actually King James I of England. Next to him is a Sultan of Turkey. And then next to him is the Sheikh Hussein, who was a descendant of Khwaja Mohinuddin Chishti. So now what's happening in this painting is that for Emperor wanted to make a statement that for him, the dignitaries of the world would not mean if there is a saint of the Khwaja Mohinuddin Chishti himself standing. He would actually favor him than anybody else in the world. And he's actually seen here presenting a book to him and not to anybody else. And on the top of the book, there is an interesting phrase written, which translates that selling all the earthly grandeur aside, it is to the spirit that the emperor submits. And in this beautiful composition, what we see is that he's not sitting in his seated on his royal throne, but he's sitting on his something is as the hourglass, which basically holds the time of the world, not just the time that he is in. And more interestingly, what we see here is there are two angels who are trying to basically control the flow of the sand, which is passing down. They're trying to control the flow of the time. They're trying to stop the time of the reign of their emperor, but obviously it failed.
Yeah. Amazing. So these are so layered. There is the world and the word and I think very deep.
And there's one more layer to it, which is in the halo, which includes both sun and moon at the same time, which basically says that the empress has conquered not just this world, but everything possible in the universe.
The philosophical statement as much as it is a one of piety, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Now the next painting is this. These are three compositions by Nen Suk, one of my favorites. And you know, there's often debate because a lot of people say that what is actually in these? They are just line drawings. Why are they so popular? Why are they so expensive? I mean, that's another thing that the prices have gone from where to where. But keeping that aside, let's try and see what makes Nen Suk what's so special. For according to me, it's the treatment of the space and the treatment of the lines that Nen Suk introduced. Now, if let's start with this composition here, which is basically of the music, which is a musical group. Yeah, now here, artists wanted to stress only and only on the musicians and the kind of music they were composing. He forgot about what was in the background, who were the audience. Whatever he wanted to stress, he painted only and only that. There is not even a distinction between a foreground and a background. There is a slight hint of line here, if we see, which we do not know whether it's the line of the dari or carpet on which they are seated, or whether it's a distinction between a foreground and the background, whether it's the division between the floor and the wall. So see here, so that's one example. The other example is this, where a nobleman wanted to enjoy the music. Again, the same thing, the same philosophy. He put aside every embellishment or everything else. He just wanted to focus on what he wanted to depict, which is this nobleman. He wants to enjoy the music and the musicians who are playing for him. There is no sense of background or foreground. They are as if, you know, they're frozen in time and in space. He wanted to create that moment wherein they could become timeless. They can be placed at any given background. You could put them in a Mughal court or in a Mewad court. You can imagine the background. But for him, it was just that stress that he wanted. And likewise, in this one colorful composition, where they are seated is again very dicey. Where they're standing is again very dicey. It's a platform we can see. But is it in the air? Is it the roof? Is it the terrace? Or is it just the carpet? We cannot actually guess it. It's left to the imagination of the onlooker.
I love this one because like your elephant picture, you can hear the trumpets playing.
The trumpets being blown, yes.
You can hear the music.
Yeah. So, you know, in ancient treatises, there is something called vyakt and avyakt, that as much as the artist is supposed to vyakt, at the same time, he should know what to not express and leave it to the imagination of the onlookers. And that's where Nen Suk mastered.
I agree because it's just brilliant. Oh, yes. Yeah.
Moving on to this one. Unfortunately, I did not have a good resolution picture of it. So what's happening in there? You know, again, like Deepthi, how we were talking about the merging of the two realms, of the two worlds, of the sacred and the profane. What we see here in the main composition is this Nayika. Now, quintessentially, it would become Radhika because of the prominence of Vaishnav tradition in the courts at that particular point of time. And Nagari Das, who was the court poet of at the Kishangarh, this painting is done in Kishangarh style. And Sawan Singh, the very famous Raja also. So this style particularly is known by two people, by the artist Nihal Chand and by the ruler Sawan Singh. So, you know, this is, if you say it is a Sawan Singh painting, yes, accepted. If you say it is a Nihal Chand painting, yes, accepted. Because these two devised this particular style and it's now popular by both of their names. So in this painting, now let's try and get into the composition. What's happening is that we see a Nayika, who we can call Radhika or Radha, is getting ready. And getting ready for what? Doing her Shringas so that she could meet her lover, who would be the Nayika in, often is again, you know, reflected as Krishna. But Krishna is not present here. And you know, like I said, that the two realms, that is this worldly and the other worldly, were often imagined at the same place, that occurring at the same time. So here what we see, that she's seated in this one beautiful garden, which has a pond as the foreground, and there is another pond or a lake in the background, and surrounding it is a beautiful palace or a fort, which is then, there is a further layer added to it, which is a river, and on the other side of the river is actually the settlement of the city or the township of Kishangarh. So we see the houses and the forts and palaces of Kishangarh. Now what we see at the hilltop is not this kingdom, but the neighboring kingdom. But what Radha's heart is longing for is for Krishna. And where is Krishna? He is not in this realm. He is somewhere up above in the clouds. So that's where we see at the top, if you see in this tiny speck, is the other world. It's a projection of the other world where Krishna is supposed to be. So you see in the image, so how this, you know, artist translated literally the imagination of Radhika. So from here, the artist is transcending from Desh to Pardesh, which is this country to the other country, at the same time from Lok to Parlok, which is this world to the other world.
I wouldn't have imagined all of that if you hadn't explained it.
Yes. So moving on to this other fascinating painting, which is from the collection of Museum of Art and Photography in Bangalore. This is a beautiful, beautiful composition from Jaipur School. It was done somewhere in 1840s. And what's happening here? You see, I think all of us probably have seen the Narsim avatar of Vishnu. But this is an unusual and a very, very rare description of Narsimha, where we see him not literally tearing apart Hiranyakashipu, but it is the moment right after he has killed him. So he, you know, see, he is his face, there is a smile on his face, he's content, he's happy with what he has done, because that was his job, that's why he was created, that's why he took the avatar, basically. And he, what he's wearing is a garland of the, you know, this, like, of the various limbs and blood of the demon. And what we see in front, our various gods came to revere him for the kind of job that he fulfilled. And right in front of him is a tiny
figure.
Prahlad, sorry, I'm confusing the names. So tiny Prahlad. So all of them are, they're basically giving their homages to him. And what's happening here is that if you see, to the left of this composition, there is an exit from which all rest of these devatas went to their respective abodes, and Narsimha also went to where he was supposed to, and probably from the same exit, Prahlad also went, but his father, who's Hiranyakashipu, had just been killed, and what his major task is now is to fulfill the last rites. That is by cremating his father. And that's what we see at the top right, that Prahlad, now he has changed to other clothes and is performing the final rites for his father. And what we see surrounding the pyre are these demons who are basically friends and confidants and comrades of the Hiranyakashipu. They also had to come and pay the last visit to the dead soul. And what we see here in the top left of the composition is basically the narration of Bhagavad Puran happening, that there is this one particular Ved Vyas, who is narrating it to the disciple, that all of this has happened, and this is how like the entire composition of different sequences came into one composition. Moving on to the other Jaipur style composition, which is basically the killing of Paritrasur. Here we see Krishna repeated at least three times while killing the Aritrasur. So it basically shows the different movements that both of they faced, you know, when they faced each other. And if we actually try and see closely at the top one, where the Krishna is encountering Aritrasur and he's literally holding it with the horns. If we try and see, Aritrasur is actually, you know, shown pooping out. It's like, you know, because he was so feared by the force of Krishna that he couldn't control himself. And he literally defecated at that particular moment. And after having killed him, Krishna, when the moment he wanted to enter into his city again, there is a moment of pause. And the creatures from the other, not the creatures, but the gods and the devatas from the heaven above, showered him the blessings, as we can see the showering of flower. And after that, he enters the city. And after he enters the city, everybody is joyous, including the cows, and where we see the peacocks dancing in the background. And also the cows are coming to greet him.
Because he's a cowherd.
Yeah, because he's a cowherd. And then he's like surrounded by the other Gopals and his brother Balram. So moving on to probably the last composition, the last selection of the painting. This is one really complex but a very, very fascinating composition. It's from the series called Rasaraj. Rasaraj was written by this poet called Matiram. And this painting was painted in Datia in the central India. And what happening in this painting is, I think I should go by the text first. So what had happened in this text was, this is also like a take on Gita Govinda, where the artist is talking about the love of Radha and Krishna. So what's happening in this painting is that Krishna is somewhere away. He has left Radhika alone, and Radhika is obviously missing him, and missing him so dearly that she tells about the features, or the facial features and the bodily features, to the Sakhi, who is the confidant. And the Sakhi is so moved by the description, by the meticulous description, that she goes and gets a painting made based on the description of Radhika and present it to Radha. Now Radha looks at the painting, which is so lifelike that she's totally engrossed in it. She forgets about the real world surrounding her. For her, now the world is that painting. And when she sleeps in the night, she dreams of this painting and Krishna again. And then she wakes up crying out loud, and she's looking at that painting again. Now the Sakhi is moved by, she can see the Radhika in distress, and then she here, if we see, she goes to Krishna and tells her about whatever is happening and requests him to come and pay a visit to Radha. So here in the presence that we see, Krishna is presented only once, and there is a picture of him, but we actually count. Krishna is literally present more than six times in the avyakt expression. You see, because here initially appears in the poetry, then when Krishna describes feature by feature to Radha, to the Sakhi, when the Sakhi gets a portrait painted, then Radha looks at it, then she sleeps and there is a dream sequence, and then she wakes up again, look at the painting, and then finally Sakhi goes and meet the Krishna.
So it's absolutely,
so that's the kind of layers we are looking at in this composition. Yeah,
it's absolutely fabulous with Krishna.
And then there's this one last painting where I wanted to stress about, you know, the how in the courtly times there would be a setup made for looking at a painting. So here, this is again a composition of Nensuk. And in this composition, behind his patron, who's Raja Balwant Singh, we see him standing and presenting his painting. And then after presenting this painting to him, he's like humbled. He's really hoping that he actually likes the creation that he has made. And to be able to see, and I'm pretty sure there is a musical performance going on, and there is a full possibility that the painter would have instructed the musicians to play a raga which could go, or the musical notes which could go along with the with the theme of the painting that he has created. And you see, there is no other crowd. It's just the king listening to the music, smoking a hookah to elevate the senses, and looking at a painting which we believe is composite of all the Pratima Lakshanas, Pratima Lakshanas, which could be revered by the onlooker. So that's the kind of setup which was, you know, created to look at a painter for the spectatorship. Now, there's this one interesting image that now in our times, when we have to look at a painting, now the fortunate group of paintings have gone to the museums that they are really taken care of. And that's where we can go and look at the paintings. But obviously the purposes of looking at the paintings have changed. And rest of the paintings, if today I want to go and buy a painting and to get that exalted, see this experience, or if I have to do the Rasa Swadan, and if I have to buy a painting, I have to go into the market. And I mean, see here, I'm not trying to basically pass any judgment, but in the tourist spots, in the tourist places in Rajasthan and Himachal Pradesh and Agra and Delhi, we often see these kind of shops where the paintings are at sale. You see, so this is the kind of like, this is not exactly, again, passing a judgment, but the kind of the change or a drastic, the contrast in the quality of spectatorship that I want to focus at.
You fall with a big thud from the Srota court to the street side. And really the onus, I think one of the things, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that the onus of the understanding and enjoyment of a painting is as much on the spectator or the viewer or the rasik or the person who looks at it, as much as it is for the person who paints it and the patron who...
You see, when a painter, according to me, when a painter makes a painting, it's only half of the job done. Until and unless it is seen by a worthy viewer, the job is not done.
Amazing.
So yeah, it's like a 50-50 job. So artist makes a painting and it's still the journey of the painting is not done. The journey of painting would get...
Only beginning.
Reaches the connoisseur when it reaches to a proper rasika,
and to the devotee or the
to a devotee, exactly,
devotee who's looking at that painting every single day in portable shrines, carries it with him. You know, it is the presence emulated through a actual chitra or a painting that he carries. That was absolutely fascinating, Sonika. Thank you so much. I'm just reaching out to the audience if at all anyone has any question. Supriya, you have to throw in one.
Yeah, maybe I'll just start off the thing. Actually, I was curious about Sonika's family and, you know, some of the things that she described as part of the training and the stages of the Chitra Sutra and all of that. You mentioned that she comes from a family where there is a long tradition of traditional painting. It would be nice if, Sonika, you could briefly share how much of that tradition is still sort of practiced, and how does that work? How do young people train there? Do they come for formal training, or is it, do they come like maybe, what are they called, apprentices? How does the system work today
in
this tradition?
Yeah, so I tell you from my experience, what I have seen in my family is that my grandfather headed the workshop. He had five sons, and all of them were the attendants or the assistants to him.
Right.
And all of us were the, you know, like the newcomers. And our job, and I tell you this not from my own family workshop, but I have seen it like in the other family workshop and in the other workshops in general of the painting activities, that, you know, it's really fascinating for the younger ones when they enter a workshop and they want to actually learn, or if they are at least interested in what is going on in the workshop, that the initial tasks which are assigned to the newcomers, you would be fascinated that it's basically washing the brushes, washing the color receptors, which are often the coconut shells and the seashells. And that is actually a very deep exercise to learn how much a color, you know, how much a brush would be filled when a master used it. What is the, you know, what is in the receptor? What is the kind of composition when you are washing it?
Lovely.
When you feel it with your fingers, how much gum and how much pigment can you, you know, when you actually then later on, when you make your own pigment, That memory remains.
Oh, wonderful.
You see, so all of these are part and parcel of... And then when the painting exercise actually starts, It is basically by, you know, drawing the basic forms, for example, jalebi pattern or spiral lines or serpentine lines or just the straight lines. And I tell you from my experience, I was made to make just the straight lines with the brush for almost a month. And I filled more than 4 to 5 files just making the leaf pattern, just mastering over the leaf, over a one single leaf pattern. And that is actually to prepare or to condition a painter so that when he has to make a bigger composition, he knows exactly the kind of leaves which would go in which tree. And it would be like a piece of cake for him then. So it's a very rigorous practice which goes in, it still goes in the workshops, I tell you.
So if I can have one more question, Dipti, now because this wonderful picture is up there. And
you read my mind. I was going to ask
her. You go ahead.
I was going to ask you why you chose this as the placeholder for your
session. So this is, again, one of my most favorite paintings of all times. And this is the title given to is called the Shiva, the Archer, where, and now Shiva, His Shiva is not a very violent god to begin with. He's a peacemaker. And I mean, he comes to play only when he's required at the end, when he does the ultimate destruction of the world. Usually by his Tandav Nritya or by his Pinak, the famous Dhanush that he carries. So here we can see that something, you know, here again, the artist left a lot to imagination, that something so drastic must have happened that Shiva had to be called. And Shiva is usually to be called. He doesn't, you know, imagine the things, or he doesn't see whatever is going around him. He's to be extolled, he's to be brought down from his divine abode in Kailasha. So he was called, obviously, when, you know, things were literally out of control and no other deities could control the situation. So he came in, and what he has to do is just like shoot one arrow out of his pinak. And what we see is here in the face is that ultimate confidence that, you know, he knew that he would shoot one arrow, then the job would be done. And this is actually a moment right after, like just a second after he shot the arrow. So the left hand is still in the air as he literally, you know, like pulled the string of the Dhanusha, and the right hand is gradually slowing down. But the eyes and the face, and especially if you see, the gaze is traveling in the direction of the arrow, which is little slightly upwards. And also the balance, because he knew he would have to shoot an arrow at the galloping bull. So he calculated everything, and the artist then calculated everything and composed his one beautiful composition, which speaks so much. It's not just Shiva shooting an arrow. This speaks of so much. We couldn't get into mythology. We can go into the, you know, the literally the lakshanas of a painting, of the colors and everything.
Yeah, that was fascinating. Absolutely. I'm looking at it with new eyes. And also sometimes looking at these miniature paintings, you see how much of it carries on, like looking at the red of this this painting in front of me, it almost reminds me of, say, a Manjeet Bhava, you know, that same kind of luminous orange in the background. And I don't know if there's any connection, but
no, there is I don't know about the connection, but I tell you why the color red, because the color was red was prescribed for the Veer Rasa. When you have to make a painting for a Veer Rasa, you are supposed to use the background red, which enhances the overall experience of the
also kind of a fiery color. But I think another day we will talk about color and the passions it invokes, which too is another fascinating session. To all of you who are asking for books and other additional reading, we'll compile something, Sonika.
Yeah, we will definitely.
And send it to you. I think, Supriya, you'll have to be the conduit.
Yeah, we can share it on Drive. And also, I was going to ask you, you know, some of these galleries where there is access to their collections online, people may...
Our own collection. I'm hoping that...
I am now excited to see the Sumaya collection.
Yeah, because I think when things swivel back a little more to the normal, we will be... hopefully, by Shiva, Krishna and all the gods' graces, be able to host an actual session where all of you can come in and look at the paintings that we have.
That would be fascinating.
It's been a massive, fantastic digitization program. And I really want to give a shout out of gratitude to the Somaya family and the Somaya Vidya Vihar University and the faculty. They've been just so encouraging. This is something so out of the box. I know how demanding your academic schedules and timings are, and just to make space for this has been absolutely remarkable, and I hope it bears fruit and comes full circle. So thank you, Supriya. I think we'll close out here.
If there are no questions from the audience, I just thought maybe no one has any question.
No, they've been asking books on things. Sonika is asking if you can share the 8 limbs of painting by Samranga Sutradhar.
Sure, sure.
Yeah, maybe you can just send that out. So Sheetal, we'll be in touch with you via email. Do email.
I think Sering has a hand up.
Sering, yeah, go ahead. Do you have
a can you unmute her?
Okay. Yeah. Hello, everyone. Yeah. Thank you for this wonderful session. And I just have one question regarding the rules that all the painters have to follow, as Sonika mentioned, for meditation and all those things. Yeah. I was just wondering whether it applies to any painter or only for the painters who paint divine pictures of God and goddesses. I was just wondering because I see those things also in Thangka, but so far what I know about Thangka is it applies only to while you are painting a god or goddesses. So I was just wondering whether it applies to every painter or...
My one-line answer would be it applies to... am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. So the one-liner answer to it, that it is applicable to all the serious painters.
All those who want to.
No, but then going back. So like you're saying that, the meditative exercise only while painting the gods and goddesses, no. The ancient prescriptive texts, they have given prescriptions and canons for making each and everything, whether you are making a painting of a bird or an animal, or whether you are making a tree, you should be meditative, you should be engrossed in the composition or in the form enough to be make it lifelike. That's why the 6 limbs of the art, you see, because they say that the forms and the colors and the similitude should be so close to the nature. And that almost it becomes, when I said that it should become a piece of for worship, it does not, like I said, it is not necessarily meaning by like the literal worshipping of it. Worshipping wherein you can literally, feel the painting in yourself, wherein you can atmasat it, where you can become a part of it. So the meditative exercise is prescribed to all, not just the painters, but to all of us.
Thank you so much, both of you, for this wonderful evening. Really enriching.
Thank you, Supriya. Thanks a lot.
And
thank you.
And opens our eyes out a little more and adds to our sense of appreciation. And thank you for this piece. I mean, I was going to ask you this, Shiva. I suppose if this is in free domain, they wouldn't mind if I printed it out and kept it on my table because it is simply stunning.
It is, right?
Because
from Indian Museum in Kolkata.
Yeah. It is, right? Because some of these things are just, you were saying about the avyakta, and here we have an image where, I mean, the minute I saw it, I can see the little bounce before as he shoots the arrow, and he is now, in that, like
relaxed.
You said, in the
confident.
You can see the before, the,
I think it
moment.
Is also a very seminal idea to our Indian philosophy of the present, of course, but also the unseen, the unknown,
across.
I mean, as someone who is you would know it, but better perhaps, Supriya, as Dharma studies, I think that is at the core of our Eastern religions, that the unknown, the unseen is always to be acknowledged. And I think there's a lot of elegance in that. And perhaps the finest painters get that.
No. So, my grandfather actually, again, I would like to quote my grandfather. He used to say that a great artist should know exactly where to stop.
Yeah.
More than what he should be doing, he should know exactly where to stop.
Superb. I think on grandfather's note,
Yeah, we should know.
Thank you.
That is very important. And bless you. Wish you a wonderful career. And keep in touch. And we will have you with us often. And Dipti, what can I say? But
Thank you so much. And here's
for inviting. Thank you very
much. Inviting many more people onto this platform. Thank you, Sonia.
Thank you.
Have a very good evening. Thank you.